A very good evening to everybody. It will be a great pleasure in our series of Friday talks. We do this every Friday. One week we do international affairs, strategic affairs. The other week we do public policy. We're now concentrating on governance. Just a 30-second brief on the Institute. This is a new Institute, no doubt. Technically, it's set up a year ago, but actually we adjusted a couple of years last year and we could not do more. Now we are picking it up and we're trying to really explore a broad range of topics with a lot of resource persons, not all of whom are regularly seen on the circuit, you know. I mean, they're very talented people, very hardworking people, lot of new ideas. And I think it's time for bring this platform to bring us together. Today's topic on Kautilya, Mehta Bisht is at the South Asian University. She has a PhD from Sipod in JNU. She's an MA from there. She's a tot. She has a published a lot, book chapters, edited volume. She's had fellowships and grants to travel outside and within the country, Millennium Challenge, etc. So it's a very good thing. And she has been working on this quite. I heard her speak a number of times. And I read her chapter in a book edited out of IDSA, where she has, I think, worked in the past by this late German scholar, Leibig. And very good. So that book is an amazing book. I think people should read it. So I thought that why not see Kautilya from different angles, including this one. We have a discussion today. I've requested Professor Himanshu Roy of the Indira Upadhyay College, Delhi University, after Professor Bish stopped speaking, 25, 30 minutes. Then I've requested Himanshu Roy to speak for another 3-4 minutes, interrogating her seriously. I mean, serious interrogation is if you find something is not logical, find something missing, please point it out. The idea is to build up a good scholarship. Being critical in a positive way is always a very good thing. And then, of course, evaluating response today would then open it up for question answers. I would control the process so that all of you get a chance. So once again, let me wish you a very, very good evening. Welcome to IPRIS. Welcome to our speaker today, Mehta Bisht. Over to you.
So thank you and good evening for having me here. It's indeed a pleasure, in fact, to have the space and really converse on, I would say, a very important topic. Firstly, at the outset, maybe I would like to express my gratitude to the Atal Bihari Vajpayee of Policy Studies and International Studies. I am thankful that I'm here. So I'll be speaking on Kautilya's Arthashastra, Lessons on Strategy. And this is, in fact, a part of my book, which was published in 2020. But here, I'm just I will just focus on the strategic aspects. Now, to begin with, you know, let me start by saying that translating classics can indeed be a daunting challenge to start with. And I say this because, let me just minimize this. Yeah, so, you know, translating classics can actually be a very daunting challenge to start with. And I say this because, you know, if you look at some of the philologists, for instance, they would argue that a text is always embedded in a context. And therefore, when you are actually translating a text, you need to be aware of the compositional history. You need to be aware of the utterances, the words, the language. And all of that matters in terms to give meaning to a specific text. Now, alternatively, on the other hand, I would argue there would be scholars who would, in fact, argue that the text needs to be liberated from the context. And the reason they would say so is because, you know, there are some texts, particularly that's why, you know, they qualify it as classics, because these classics, they have questions which can often, you know, have a universal appeal. And it's primarily, I would say, taking this line of argument further, that I would argue that, you know, when we revisit a classic like Arthashastra, it's important that while we are aware of the context, the specific historical cultural moment when a particular text is composed, we also need to liberate it from the context a bit. And it is here that I would offer to you a template on the grand strategic design in Kautilya's Arthashastra, something which I have dwelled upon in my book. And I would say that this template is important because it could really help us to develop hypotheses in foreign policy in order to advance knowledge, I would say, not only in terms of theorizing, say, for instance, international relations, but also trying to understand the practice of international relations. And this is where I feel that Arthashastra can offer significant insights. Now, to just give you some facts on the text, I'm sure the audience here is well aware, but the text was discovered fairly recently in the 20th century. And since then, there has been a lot of intellectual discussion around the text, particularly on questions related to the identity of the author and the text and the periodization of Arthashastra. So, for instance, a group of scholars would argue that Arthashastra is not written by one hand. It's written over a period of time by different hands, and Kautilya perhaps was a myth and there were people impersonating as Kautilya. On the other hand, there would be others, who argue that Arthashastra not necessarily was written between the 2nd to the 4th century BC, as Kangle writes, but in fact, it was written over a period of time. And in fact, Mark McLeish, in his recent book, argues that Arthashastra was composed over a period of 100 years. Notwithstanding these debates, though, I would argue that while these debates are important in terms of reifying the historicity of the text, Arthashastra is really a text. It's an example, it's an exemplar of how philosophy and strategy were reconciled. And since I'm talking about philosophy here, let me bring to the upfront this whole notion of anvikshiki, which in fact Kautilya calls as the methodology of the text. Anvikshiki also being translated as philosophy of knowledge. And Arthashastra in fact mentions in book one that anvikshiki is the lamp of all sciences. And what constitutes anvikshiki? Kautilya says it's Samkhya, Yoga, and Lokayat philosophy which constitute anvikshiki. Now this is significantly important because not only this is highlighting an element of critical skepticism in terms of reading the text, because the three philosophical Hindu traditions, which are in fact encompassed in the definition of anvikshiki, are quite contradictory in nature. But it also, in a way, tells us, how to really make sense of the reality outside us. And since in my past talks, I have focused a lot on the philosophical underpinnings, I thought for today's talk, as the title itself suggests, I would be interested in talking a bit about the strategic underpinnings of Arthashastra. And these strategic underpinnings, which is primarily the chapter 3, which I take forward in 4, 5, 6, 7 in my book, are significant. And I would say that there are two significant insights which one really gets. The first, I would say, is the idea of the political. Now, this idea of the political is a pre-Westphalian idea of the political. Kautilya here, when he's really talking about the idea of the state Saptanga theory, it's a layered conceptual thicket of what a state should be. It's not really about privileging institutions as an organized structure. It is not a black box, but it includes physical and natural environment. And therefore, the state or the idea of the state or this entity, which we are sort of defining as a state, becomes important to understand. And the second strategic insight, which I think Arthashastra again offers us, is how does one really identify a friend and an enemy? And that itself is important because once you understand what constitutes the political, you would understand who is a friend and who is an enemy, anyone against the political, the state, is considered to be an enemy or a kanta. Now, I would like to take this conversation forward and in fact, dwell a bit upon, the meaning or what I understand from grand strategy. Because what I argue is that, we should in fact look at Arthashastra as a text which has a grand strategic design into itself. So, if one really talks about the presence of strategic thought, definitely it was present in ancient India. Now, if you really look at grand strategy, and suppose one was to really give a general definition of what a grand strategy means, it would essentially mean using the available resources in order to meet the desired political objective. And I would also state here perhaps that there are two important aspects which are associated with grand strategy. The first is the context. You know, you cannot really ignore the context. You need to be aware of the context in terms of operationalizing a grand strategy. So the context is important. And I would say the second is that grand strategy essentially is an ecological construct. And what this essentially means is that when one is really talking about the grand strategic design, one needs to understand how parts are related to the whole. And you need to see grand strategy in therefore a holistic manner. That becomes very important. Now, if you really look at the consensus among scholars as to how they've defined grand strategy, they primarily define it in terms of a triad: the ends, the ways, and the means. Ends are definitely the political objectives that you want to attain. The means, I would say, would be really the techniques, the stratagems. Here, the techniques, when translating into Arthashastra, become the Saptang and Shaktigunya theory. I'll come to that. But more importantly, I would say that the means is really the way. The way, in fact, is the method. You know, it's really that umbrella framework which justifies certain political actions which you take. The way, in a way, is very important because it is also indicative of a specific geocultural thinking. Ways of thinking matter in international politics. Geographies of thought matter in international politics. And these ways of thinking are very important to understand if one was to make sense of these terms like justice, like morality, like power, like state, like sovereignty, in international relations. So ways of thinking really matters. And it's primarily this triad, which I would say that I take further in terms of really understanding the grand strategic thought in Arthashastra. And let me just speak a few lines on that. So when we are actually talking about the ends, it's very interesting because Kautilya mentions that Yogasham is the primarily end which the state needs to serve. And Yogasham is primarily safeguarding the security and the well-being of the people. So that's the meaning of Yogasham, because at one instance, Kautilya also writes, in the success and the happiness of the people also lies the happiness of the king. And that's important, I guess. So the duties of the ruler were very much specified. They were raksha, which was protection of state from external aggression, palan, which was maintenance of law and order, and Yogasham, which was safeguarding the welfare of the people. The second was, of course, the method, as I said, the way, the dharma. And dharma is again important because in Hindu philosophy, dharma was not equated with a theocratic framework, but it was understood more as a way of life, which in fact became a normative guide for the king and the subjects in political and social affairs. And one of the striking patterns, and this is something which I also argue in my book, one of the striking patterns which emerges from Arthashastra is its emphasis on dharma, which is interpreted as order, and how maintaining and regulating this order essentially became the purpose behind the idea of state and statecraft. So this cosmic understanding of dharma, the word dharma etymologically coming from the word dharya, to hold together, or dharti, something which holds together, is important. And therefore, when you look at these strategic texts, I would say that in Kautilya's Arthashastra, dharma is really that reflexive lens which helps you to judge the world. And after judging comes your understanding of knowing and understanding the world. And I think that's important in terms of understanding some of these non-Western texts when we're really trying to translate them in terms of understanding the international and some of these concepts which we study as students of international relations. Now, means is again important. Now, means is important because essentially these were the stratagems, these were the techniques, these were the instruments through which order could be regulated. Now, when it really comes to the level of the state or the Saptanga theory, danda was that means through which order could be regulated. Therefore, it was known as legitimate force. When you actually move on to the circle of states, the mandala, it was really the Shatgunya theory, or the six methods of foreign policy, which in fact regulated the balance or the order in the circle of states. Now, that's important because balancing the mandala, in fact, is one of the primary tasks, which Kautilya sort of takes up on himself and talks about these stratagems, which then become meaningful when we are actually talking about, how state and statecraft really have been explained. Now, let me move in further. And perhaps really get into the idea of the state and the idea of statecraft, because I would say that these two really are the central pillars for understanding the grand strategic design of Arthashastra. Mostly as students of international relations, we focus on the mandala, we focus on the four rupayas, the six measures of foreign policy, the friend-enemy dialectics, which is presented there, and we stop there. But I think one needs to dig in deeper, and the state becomes very important. And therefore, the idea of the state, is significantly important in terms of understanding the Kautilyan, understanding the Kautilyan idea of state and statecraft. So, when you look at the state was, of course, had seven constituent elements. If you see, the king was the supreme leader. The first few chapters or the books in Arthashastra are primarily on disciplining human nature. Now, that's very interesting because Kautilya takes hold of human nature here, and the disciplining of human nature, was considered to be very, very important. Then it's followed really by the council of ministers, the people who counsel the king, the intellectual power, which is followed by, of course, the territory and the population, where he's talking about legitimacy and the people and morality, plays an important role in terms of seeking support of the population. And then he's in fact talking about defensive power, economic power, offensive power. Won't get into the details there. But significantly important here is Mitra. Now, Mitra is important because Mitra is, in fact, the seventh constituent element of the state, the internal constituent element of the state, the ally. And here it's very important because what you really see that, the external and the internal is deeply intertwined. Allies were really defined as something or as actors which helped increase the relative power. And it's again very interesting because, it's been specified that power is needed or power needs to be employed to strengthen the state. The purpose of the power is clear. The purpose of the power is success, and success is further defined as happiness. And it's to that detailed analysis that Kautilya really goes into. And for certain takeaways in terms of understanding the state, now all these constituent elements had outstanding features, characteristics, prakritis, which in fact had to be constantly regulated, cultivated, and monitored. And one way to cultivate these outstanding features or these excellencies of the state were the tests of deception, upadhas, or espionage. Again, significantly important because the idea was to maintain the prakriti, these seven elements. The more proximate a state was to these seven elements, the more superior a state was. The more distant it was from these seven elements, the more weak a state was. So thus entity or the state, I would say here in Kautilya's Arthashastra, and to my mind that's important, is not given. It evolved organically. And the character of entity determined the inferior and the superior character of the state. And that I think is very important because the state is therefore always work in progress. Also, actors increasing the capacity of the state were allies. So when it really comes to your foreign engagements, diplomatic engagements, any engagement which is actually helping you augment your capacity comes within the framework of an ally. Now, this is the mandala. As you see, it's a combination of permutation, a combination of actors there. 12 actors is what Kautilya says. But for simplification purposes, I'll say that there are five actors here. The first is the conqueror, the aspirant power. Anyone could be the conqueror or the aspirant power. Then there were the sets of allies. There were the sets of enemies. And then there were two negotiating partners, important. The first was the neutral power and the second was the middle power. The Madhyaman or the middle power was close to the aspirational conqueror and the enemy, somewhere close to your geographical territory. The second, the Udasin, was a neutral power, was distant from both the aspirational conqueror and the enemy. And the whole idea of mandala, what I really read from the text, is how to utilize the neutral power and the middle power in terms of checkmating the enemy. So how do you actually use these actors for your own advantage? And the state is a purposive actor because the idea of the state is to really augment its own capacity. So that becomes important. Now, as I said, it's very important before we get into the analysis of enemy and friend in Kautilya's Arthashastra, we have a clarity as to what how Kautilya defines them. So for instance, he categorizes enemies and he categorizes friends. So when he's talking about enemies, he's saying that the three types of enemies: a dangerous enemy, a weak enemy, and a vulnerable enemy. And who is an enemy? And that's important again. An enemy is an actor who possesses all the excellencies. That is, the seven outstanding elements are really there. It's a superior state to a certain extent. But within those categories also, you need to differentiate. A vulnerable enemy will be an enemy where the seven elements are weak. Maybe the economy is weak, maybe the leader is weak. It could be any of those. A weak foe is an enemy who has no allies, has weak state, has been probably isolated. And a dangerous enemy is an enemy who has territorial congruity to you, has material interests clashing with you, and is of course, an enemy by birth, enemy to your survival, is a danger to your survival. Then he talks about friends also. These friends were dangerous friends, worthy friends, and best friends. Interesting. So when he talks about best friends, he's saying that common interest is the first principle for choosing an ally. Offering help was the second characteristic. And Kautilya says that this is a worthy friend, allies or actors who give you help, irrespective of the time, are worthy friends. You should never let them go. But then there's something called the dangerous ally. And the dangerous ally, he says, needs to be further understood through a three-lens criteria, through three-tiered criteria of controllability, constancy, and the ability to mobilize truth. So he says that, if you have an ally, but the ally cannot really mobilize troops within its own, has no internal control over its own territory, or is not very consistent, then it could be a dangerous enemy. And in that case, you should probably go for someone whom you rely on, who's very consistent, even though, it would be quite proximate to all the seven core elements, the seven excellencies that he talks about. Now, I think this is important because this really gives meaning to the mandala or the circle of states. Now, there is a definite geographical determinism, of course, which has been contested now, that there is no geographical determinism in Kautilya's Arthashastra, but definitely geography is important. It's not one of the elements, it's not the element, it is one of the elements. But apart from that, in terms of understanding the enemy and the friend, and it's important to identify who the enemy and the friend is. Because only when you identify who your enemy or a friend is, would you be able to operate or operationalize the policies or the tactics or the stratagems, right? So motivation and intention becomes important. And he says that, how do you understand the motivation? He says that motivation stems from the internal cohesion of the seven constituent elements. So more cohesive or more superior a state is, the more you should be aware of that particular state. And he says that the second way is to really understand the intention. And intent of the actor is determined through the criteria of differentiating a friend from an enemy. So something which I really talked about. And once you have a clarity on this, then he really goes into, the purpose of statecraft. And the purpose of statecraft, as I understand Kautilya's Arthashastra, was primarily to build alliances and to sustain them. So how do you build alliances? And how, and he talks about treaty making, which I feel treaty making is important because it helps sustaining a particular alliance. So to wind up the argument, I would say that state and statecraft are interconnected in Kautilya's Arthashastra. Interestingly, Kautilya is talking about constituent elements. He's saying there are seven constituent elements in the state, but there are 72 constituent elements in the mandala. Now, what are these 72 constituent elements? I think this needs to be understood, and I'll come back to this question later. But the most powerful enemy was the one which had its domestic seven constituent elements in place, and how the seven elements could be strengthened and enhanced by forging external alliances. That is, the six measures of foreign policy was the primary end goal of statecraft. And as I said, I already spoke on that. So this is where I think the 72 constituent elements come into play. And you need to see this in clusters. So if you see, there are four circles here, subcircle one, the aspiring state is there in the middle, followed by the ally, and then the ally is ally. The seven constituent elements, here the six, because the ally goes from there, the actor goes from there, needs to be chosen on those bases. Only allies which have these seven constituent elements can be actually defined and categorized into a dangerous or into a worthy or into a best ally. The second circle too, it really talks about the ambitious state again in the middle. And any state could actually have this template there, followed by the enemy and the enemy's ally. The enemy's ally also needs to be judged from the seven constituent elements. You know, you cannot really blindly think that this is an enemy, this is a friend. You need to be really aware of the seven elements of the state. Interestingly, subcircle three and subcircle four is very important because it really talks about, again, the Vijigishu being in the center, surrounded by the enemy, and then surrounded by the neutral power. And similarly, again, the Vijigishu in the center, surrounded by the enemy, surrounded by the middle power. And again, your choice of the middle power and the neutral power should be based on the seven constituent elements and how you really use them against the enemy. I mean, that becomes the key criteria in terms of using these policies. So I'll come to the Shadgunya, the six methods of foreign policy, because I primarily see them as bargaining strategies. Arthashastra is not a text of conflict transformation, neither conflict resolution. It's just a text plain and simple of conflict management. It gives meanings to alliances through pacts and treaties. Now, if you see, peace and war are two aspects which have been talked about. I hope I'm in time, another maybe 5 minutes. So peace, it's again interesting because peace and war are not really sort of need to be translated in the literal sense. You know, peace, for instance, could primarily mean a temporary contract. You know, something through which you could actually buy time. To in fact increase your ability. Or perhaps it could be a formal treaty with specific conditions, which lays down the parameters of a formal peace treaty. And this is followed by war. War is not necessarily war fighting the battlefield, but it's primarily incurring injury or hostilities. You know, it's primarily identifying tactics, stratagems to weaken the enemy, or probably employing covert strategies, which Cotillia also talks about. War is essentially a political strategy. You know, that's important. And therefore, I think this categorization, again, when he's talking about the six methods of foreign policy. Staying quiet is indifferent, which means that doing nothing, but that doesn't mean no policy. No policy is also some policy. Maybe when you're really trying to stay quiet, you're really trying to build your capacity. Then is followed by marching. Marching is really the preparation of war. And people say, scholars have said that, staying quiet and marching was really a transition from, say, peace to war. It's really marching your troops in a full preparation of war, signaling that the tensions are really serious. And then you have seeking shelter. Seeking shelter is, you're inferior to a particular state. But when you're seeking shelter, doesn't mean that you're submitting yourself. It means that you're biding your time. You know, you're saying that, okay, I'm taking shelter, but I shall bide my time. And in the process, what you will do is that your focus should be on increasing the internal capacity of the state, because that is the primary goal of the state. And then dual policy is where there is two front war, and it's really coming heavy on the state. You actually, make peace with your enemy. But again, that peace is not a stable peace. It's really a peace where you are actually buying time for yourself. Now, again, some of the important takeaways: the meaning of success and power is not absolute but relative. And this is important. You know, in the mandala, you cannot really have an absolute understanding of power. Your understanding of power comes vis-a-vis that of the other. The idea of the superior state and the inferior state, you know, is always in conversation. The focus is also on how does one synergize one's strategies with others and becomes aware of one's and others' constituent elements. States are not black boxes, according to Kautilya's Arthashastra. How effectively does one formulate alliances and checkmates the enemy? That is the end goal of statecraft. Allies need to be strengthened. Efforts should be directed towards reducing power of the enemy. That's what the end goal is. And the status of the dominant power, again, you need not to be seen in isolated terms, but in relation to the other. Another important point, which I think I'll just flag off here, that the ally here is not the Mitra ally, which is in fact mentioned there. So when you're really talking about peace, it could really be temporary peace. And you need to be aware of that categorization. So Shadbhuni is in fact a theory, the six methods of foreign policy, which have a sense of dynamism to it. It's a guide to the state to sort of situate strategies in different situations. He's very clear in terms of saying that when in decline, make peace, when prospering, make war. Peace means pact and entering. Making pacts and allies does not equal Mitra. These are just short-term alliances for tactical purposes. War means not only marching, but preparation for war, or even transitioning to war. It could be a matter of political signaling. However, starting war, and this is very important, starting war involves serious contemplation and specification. And only one should get into war when you are sure about your superior strength and that the war is going to benefit you. If there is an element of doubt, then you shouldn't really go for war. You'd perhaps try other strategies. And there is no harm in that. The purpose was strengthening one's position in the mandala by focusing on seven constituent elements, as I said, and indirect confrontation or approaches are preferred. And this again is important, how to use a middle power or how to use your ally in terms of weakening the enemy, on various fronts. So war is a political rather than a military strategy. Outsmarting the opponent, as Kautilya says, was a better option than defeating him. So thus, I would say Arthashastra is against inertia. This is the political wisdom that Kautilya offers. It emphasizes on the relative understanding of the state. It is about means, stratagems, upadhas, upayas, the shadgunya one needs to adopt to reach the desired goal. I've talked about the desired end goal. Arthashastra is about learning the craft of acquiring and protecting the state from both internal and external threats. Alliance building and treaty making become important instruments of statecraft again. And Kautilya also has this typology of treaties with conditions and treaties without conditions and also unequal treaties. So he's even suggesting unequal treaties, and it's very fascinating the kind of examples and explanation he's giving. So, I would say that Kautilyan approach has a resemblance to a network analysis to my mind, because it's studying patterns of connections. It's studying who is connected to whom, what is connected to what, and how they are connected. It is a network-based understanding where the notion of relatedness actually informed how governance, Rajaniti, and strategy, that is Kootaniti, need to be perceived. Kootaniti was in fact subservient to Rajaniti to a certain extent. Insights on strategy, I would say, the first thing is understanding of the political. That's very important. It's more composite, holistic. There is a mention of both human and non-human elements there when we're really talking about the political. We talk about non-traditional security threats today, but I think Kautilya's Arthashastra, a detailed account is taken of famines, of earthquakes, of disasters. So political was something much more comprehensive. It was not really siloed or compartmentalized. It really helps you to identify the friend and the enemy, the neutral power and the middle power. Primarily, it's a relational model. And therefore, I say, when you're really trying to study, the kind of wisdom that Kautilya offers is that the what to study is really the relational ontology. It's how you really study relations. And this is quite sort of, clear when he says the enemy is situated between the two, the leader and the ally becomes easy to exterminate even if strong. Again, Kautilya is a text on bargaining. It's primarily a text on non-verbal communication. And that, I think, is also distinct about a non-Western text like Kautilya's Arthashastra. Not so much on negotiations, but on non-verbal communication, which I think is, again, a very important part of South Asian identity. The way we speak, the way we address our elders, I think, more comes with the idea of culture there. And again, it also dwells a lot into the relationship between force and statecraft, where force needs to be used, but always as the last resort. So, yes, the conclusion finally, this is something, which I have over and over argued. It's definitely relevant to the discipline of IR, not from the lens of whether it fits into a realist theory or a liberal theory or a constructivist approach, but more in terms of the meta-theoretical approach it really offers in terms of trying to understand an alternative cosmovision It makes a, I hear in this book, therefore I make a revisionist case for understanding Arthashastra. I liberate it from the narrow frames of theories, but present him as a grand strategist. And what I really see in Arthashastra is that there is a continuous pattern, which is reflective of the interdependence between the constituent elements, which are primarily mediate, which primarily mediate the internal, which is the state, and the external, which is the statecraft realm. So this is what I had to say, and maybe we can just go on for the discussion now.
Yeah, lovely. Thank you very much, Dr. Best. You have been really very, been able to bring out these nuances of Arthashastra. People see it very simply, Rajamandala, etc. And just to take one small point, 2,300 years before Clausewitz, we said, Arthashastra says, that war is the last option and war is political. War is nothing but political through armed means. No, so I think this kind of nuanced understanding is very important for all of us. Before I ask our discussants to take over, I had just one small announcement to make. I should have done it in the beginning, but since many people don't stay on till the end, you just saw the richness of this presentation, how useful it is to students and to others, of course. And a lot of it is very specific to your exam alone, maybe future, other things. And just to give you a flavor of the kind of thing you can expect from us. Now, on the second of July, Dr. Ashima Goel will speak on COVID-19 recovery and macroeconomic risks. As I said, we do this. On the 9th, Antara Ghoshal Singh, another very, very fine young scholar, he'll speak on China's strategic discourse in India in the backdrop of the LSE crisis. Then we have Ila Patnaik speaking on Atmanirbhar Bharat. We have Harsh Pant speaking on global power shifts. We have a book discussion on Indus. We have Sengupta, Dipankar Sengupta speaking again on public expenditure. The point I'm trying to make is, I think for young people, if we're able to give 1 hour in a week, I think we really, I mean, we try our best to could get good speakers to you, but it's up to you to take advantage and see how best to. So with that, let me request Dr. Himanshu Roy to give us a discussion point of view for the next 4-5 minutes. And the screen sharing, over to you.
Medha's presentation, as most of the political science teachers and students of ancient history, reading Kautil is a sort of mandatory thing, and they are well versed in their reading of Kautil. So in abstraction, what she has presented is absolutely interesting and fine, at least to the students and those who do not belong to this stream of strategies and IR and political science, at least. We have been familiar listening and reading these kind of strategies of Arthashastra and different interpretations. 2 to 3 points I find slightly that needs to be taken. Of course, Medha had said that in abstractions, he is discussing about the strategies. One, of course, was when he was writing Kautil, there was no democracy, it was monarchy. Number one, today in contemporary times in India, we are a democracy and a highly developed democracy. The second, which is a major strategic shift that has occurred today, is the role of the transnational corporations, which has a massive investment in each other's country and play a very important role in making wars, etc., etc. And we have seen in the last 30, 40 years in the case of Iraq and in other parts of the world. In Kautil's time, there was nothing like transnational corporations or the economic integrations. Thirdly, the way the world is uniting in the terms of European Union, Southeast Asia, NAFTA, where the boundary of the nations have been transcended substantively, if not completely. The boundaries of the nation is still there territorially. But in terms of emotional integration, that political boundaries have been transcended. That itself, how far it will be a countermeasure to Kautilian strategy, needs And I think if Medha takes into account these two points, that can be better, or rather she can explain here how she can tackle these aspects of transnational cooperation's role, or the role of the multinational integrations in terms of people's awareness and consciousness. Just one historicality of before I hand over the mic to the host, Shakti Sinha sir. Kottil was built up in the context of nationalists' movement when the colonial rulers were derogating us day in, day out. And that built up by the nationalist school in 1910 by Lajpat Rai and then Tilak and Aurobindo to show to the world that, look, we have a history. And we had a history, fascinating history, which is now gradually getting excavated and explored, the temple towns and the other civilizations. Taking into account this historicality, this fascination for Kottil, even in contemporary times, does he make a difference in terms of a strategic knowledge, apart from abstraction and theoretical formulation that Megha concluded with? Any difference in terms of knowledge, number one. Number two, how does Kottil is different from, say, Machiavelli, say, from Kamandak in India in 8th, 9th century, or Giaberni in 14th, 15th century? Because anyone who is writing on the estate and its security is talking about almost the similar thing across the world. What Kottil had written, say, around 2,400 years ago. So with this, I wind up and hand over to Shakti Sinha sir. Thank you.
Sir, you are mute.
Sorry. Huh. I always mute myself as a matter of discipline, and I forget one mute myself. My apologies. Now, there's a point raised by Dr. Vijayalakshmi Barara. Before I raise it, in fact, I would slightly deviate this thing from Himanshu. In the sense that if somebody I want to compare Kautilya with, it would not be Machiavelli, it would not be Barthe, it would be with Morgenthau. Morgenthau's concept of the constituents of the state, you know, in the 1930s, hence Morgenthau in the 1930s. That is the closest that you have seen somebody writing on IR, looking at internal affairs so seriously, you know, comes to the comprehensive national park kind of thing, you know, and the seven elements to it, etc. Very, very important. Now, Dr. Brara has raised a point, and she takes off from where Medha started, which is that context here becomes very important. And others, please raise your hands. I'll pass it on after to this, to and to this point of Dr. Brara. Context here becomes very important because his text is based on kingship, same point that Himanshu was making, and therefore its core is to protect the state and the king. I would slightly, the state yes, but maybe not the king. I'll slightly disagree, I'll leave it at that. More importantly, I think, and this is very crucial, what does it say about the Janpad? For me, the talk will be incomplete without involving the praja and the cultural context. In the sense, the reason I say I disagree with the state is king is that both of you, Himanshu and Vijayalakshmi, is, as you know, the seven elements to the state. King is one of the elements. King is not the element. This is very unusual anywhere in the world to treat the king and his ministers and his army as separate entities. This is remarkable. This is absolutely remarkable. Very, very modern. So you can take these questions. Then I will turn to Dr. Nagendra Singh. His hand was there, but it disappeared. Dr. Mahapatra. But in the meantime, Medha will tell us how you can liberate it from the context and yet be contextual. Over to you. Please unmute yourself.
Yes. Yeah. Thank you. You know, in fact, thank you for these questions. And interestingly, personally, you know, I have also been thinking a lot about it. These are the highs and the lows which you go across when you're writing a book, which I remember I picked up with great excitement. But then, you know, these questions do really come to your mind and they start animating your imagination in multiple ways, perhaps the ways you've also talked about. A few points, and I'll try to be as succinct as possible. Definitely, you know, the context is different, and I really don't disagree with that. You know, Kautilya, of course, it's 2,000 years old, and how do you actually contemporize a text which is 2,000 years old? Having said that, you know, it's important nevertheless to revisit texts, you know, which belong to your ancient past, because they give you something very significant about knowing things. You know, they're a significant source of epistemic knowledge. And let me just, you know, perhaps unpack this. So for instance, you know, when you look at Kautilya's Arthashastra, dharma becomes very important. Now, if you look at this tradition of dharma and how this tradition of dharma has actually evolved over a period of time, you know, that itself becomes very, very significant in terms of understanding social thought in India. So for instance, interestingly, and, you know, Kautilya talks about upaya, Sam, Dan, Dan, the Ved. Later on, during Buddhism, the Lotus Sutra or the Mahayana Buddhism really talks about the Sakushal Upay, skillful means. So, you know, it's very, very, and then you get into maybe, you know, later on in the modern period, when you get into the conversation between Gandhi and Tagore, again, they have a very different understanding of dharma. So I think, you know, when we are actually looking at the concept or this tradition of dharma, we need to first look at the own civilizational history of India and how these traditions have evolved so that we can make use and have a good taste of that civilizational legacy, because I think that needs to be done. It's definitely there, but I think, you know, it needs to be put more in a systematic manner. So, and dharma is important in Kautilya's Arthashastra, because if you do not really understand dharma translated as duty, And duty, of course, you know, he's talking about the varna and the karma also. And therefore, I call him a strategist, a grand strategist trying to use the available means in terms of achieving a desired political end. He's definitely talking in a context which is 2,000 years old. And definitely, when you are actually trying to contemporize Arthashastra, say, in the 21st century, you need to be aware, you need to be actually mindful, you know, of these. And this is something, you know, which I also write in my book extensively, particularly in the last part of the book. And there is where I think the philosophical underpinnings of Arthashastra is very important to understand. You know, why he's talking about Samkhya Yoga and Lokaya all in one breath is important, because it's sort of indicating towards critical skepticism. Now, second thing, you know, you talked about TNCs, and interestingly, I, you know, I teach a course on networks and international relations, and it's very interesting because this is one, again, epistemic value that I draw in Arthashastra. I do not really see them as states, you know, these are these entities. And I think what Arthashastra is leading you to, it's telling you a different way of seeing the world, a networked understanding of the world. And therefore, when you really look at some of the literature on network studies, primary science and technology studies, you know, as it is there, you feel that, you know, this kind of work speaks more to Kautilya's Arthashastra, I would say, than a realist or a constructivist, which definitely, you know, speaks to it. But I would say a networked approach, a more relational understanding of how parts are related to each other, how different constituent elements are related to each other, you know, that becomes important. Again, on the epistemic value, and I think, you know, like I have been, you just echoed me, because I have been thinking about these questions for a long time. Now, of course, you know, when we're talking about these pre-Westphalian understanding of the political, it's a very different understanding. The post-Westphalian understanding of the political is very different. And of course, we know that how the project of the nation state itself did injustice to this sensibility called South Asia, primarily when you look at the borderlands and look at the overlapping histories. But let me just end with this small thing, and that's the epistemic value which I get from Arthashastra. Now, if you know, my professor, I was in fact reminded of Professor Pushpeshwan when I looked at you when I was listening to you, Shakti ji. But you know, he always used to say that why is Mahabharata a great epic? You know, Mahabharata is a great epic because it really braids the micro with the macro. You know, within one larger story, there are these multiple stories, and that is what makes Mahabharata a macro, a great epic. Mm-hmm. Similarly, when you look at Arthashastra, the epistemic value or the knowledge that you draw from it is that the meta-narrative of the state and the micro-narrative you know, is deeply intertwined. Now, this is important. For instance, I work on water diplomacy, and something which I see really in terms of foreign policy of South Asia, that there is a meta narrative of diplomacy. There is a meta narrative of water diplomacy. The micro narratives are very, very different from what we are actually talking at, say, the bilateral level. And I think the challenge for Indian statecraft there is to really braid the micro with the macro, you know, is to really talk about governance when you talk about statecraft. And I think this is the epistemic value, rather than a literal translation. These are the kind of insights I think we need to draw from these ancient texts.
Yeah, you have very detailed explanation, and we have lots of visitors. I'm so glad I can see a friend from Germany watching it also. Good to see you, Britta. Very good, in fact, to see you. You know, Aniket Mahapatra raised the point, can we use Kautilya to basically confront China? While you think about it, Dr. Nagendra Singh, please go ahead with your question.
Yes, thank you very much, Shakti Sinha and Dr. Bist. I really enjoyed thoroughly. I'm sorry for a while the electricity and something happened with my laptop. I have a very simple questions because I haven't read enough, but I have been reading Kautilya Arthashastra more from the entrepreneurial history and my work that is going on from the entrepreneurship school of point of view. So my question is, if you say Kautilya was all that Arthashastra, why did he name Arthashastra? It was all Rajniti Shastra. So why he chose to name Arthashastra when entire elaborations and the depth of analysis which you presented, which has been done, is Rajniti Shastra? When I happened to visit sometime back for one of the seminar in National Defense Academy, quite some time back, I found they spent a lot of papers, a lot of electives are taught of Kautilya in the strategic warfare. And that is how they say that the Montgomery, the British army chief, before they went in alliance in 1935, they did the major work of research on Kautilya. So this is where, do you see why Arthashastra was named at all? Because there is hardly anything on economic activism, hardly anything on economic power, as if there is synonymous of economic power and military power.
You made your point. You made a point.
Thank you.
Please go ahead. Please go ahead.
Respond that?
Yeah, please respond. Yeah.
So, you know, yes. So maybe taking this second question first, you know, now that's an interesting question you asked me, you know, why is Arthashastra called an Arthashastra? Because, you know, Arthashastra, Kautilya's Arthashastra is just one, right? There were preceding Arthashastra, there was already an Arthashastra tradition. There were 12 or 13 Arthashastra which were written before the Kautilya's Arthashastra. But what he's essentially doing here is that he is really trying to get in the sciences and give us a very holistic view of what does the science of politics means. The science of politics is not just dandaniti, it's not just the use of the rod, but it's also about other aspects. And and of course, you know, so I mean, one can go in different directions, but the idea of you know, calling it Arthashastra, there is, in fact, a lot of focus on acquisition of land, on prosperity. So that itself, you know, because he says, he talks about the Lokayat tradition. The Lokayat tradition itself was the materialist tradition. So he doesn't want to really negate that. But I think when he's really talking also about the Samkhya and the Yoga, while he's talking about material prosperity, he's also really talking about the spiritual undertones, you know, which are very important in terms of the pursuit of success. So, you know, that's something which I would say is important, but he's really trying to reconcile the spiritual and the material in Arthashastra in a significant way. And that itself is seen across because he's really talking about the prakirtis, he's really talking about discipline, he's talking about righteousness, and he's really trying to make sense of the politics, you know, within that framework. So that's what I have to say. But interestingly, you know, there was one question on confronting China, you know, like, in fact, in my book, I do not really take these contemporary questions, but I do offer a framework. And I think this is for the first time that I really talk just about the strategic aspects. I thank you for this. I thought that, you know, let me see whether of what use is Arthashastra to the 21st century. Initially, I was very, very, I think, you know, holding myself back. But interestingly, you know, his use of the Madhyaman and the Udasin. Now, if you really look at how do you really confront China? China is definitely a hostile actor. I mean, you know, from it's an enemy, really, which is a formidable enemy. Therefore, you know, the first suggestion which Kautilya would give is that bide your time, increase your strength, and, you know, look at the governance aspects. Because I think, you know, when you talk about China and India, there is a huge asymmetry between them. But having said that, you know, Kautilya is not about isolating, you know, a particular state or an entity. You know, he's talking about alliance building. And when I think, you know, you are actually talking about alliances, and you really try to look at, you know, who could be the Madhyaman, or who could be the neutral power, you know, I think India also needs to put the gaze towards Russia and Japan to a certain extent when it really comes to a foreign policy dealings. Because I think, you know, we're moving into a world where alliances are actually will play a major role. And the kind of relationship we'll have with Russia and Japan, you know, in the coming days, you know, would really matter. And I think that would be one way of really confronting China, doing alliances, picking, you know, making alliances, but more importantly, also focusing on the internal strength, you know, building your internal capacity, but also engaging China, you know, not having a confrontationist attitude with China, but also trying to engage China on various things. But with that, you know, end objective in mind of increasing your internal capability. So that is what I would say is the Kautilyan wisdom.
Excellent, excellent. We're running out of time. You want to add, Himanshu, very quickly before I end this session?
Just to add to what Medha answered to the first question of Nagesh Ji, that why not Rajniti Shastra? One of the professors asked me that why is there anything called a Raj Shastra in ancient India? And there is nothing like Raj Shastra or Rajniti Shastra, because the academic fashion or the philosophical fashion of the time was on the political economy, if I'm used to the contemporary word, political economy. So because of the political economy, it was called Arthashastra. That was one of the reasons.
I will now take up two other questions for lack of time. Is that one, you know, very good point has been made by Komal Khandelwal. While talking about the international, we have completely ignored the non-Western scholarship, for example, Tagore's. Enlightenment did not get... So what are the parameters that Kautilya has denied recognition? So that is a very big question to answer. Part of the fault is ours. Why blame the West for it? What have we done? I mean, as I said, we skimmed Kautilya. I'm very excited about Kautilya. Without really going into, again, this question was very good. You have to really understand why it is called the Arthashastra. It is political economy. It is the welfare of the people. Unka hit. But it's not the welfare state. So Arth is, that was the philosophical schools running through. But Komal Khandelwal, my answer to you is, if you look at some of the work being done by Rahul Sagar, he's done an amazing amount of work done, how in the 19th and the 20th century, till the Nehruvian consensus picked up, how Indians were thinking about the world, how, you know, Tagore was very clear on it, we cannot become like Europe in terms of violence, but we can gain a lot from Europe. And it's a spiritual part of Europe that they really like. So, you know, lots of good thinking about it. If we can have a full session on it, I don't think it's fair to load Medha at this time with that. Abhishek Ranjan, I think you've signed off, but you also made a very good point that it's not much about the maritime domain. Maritime has now become prominent. If you could, Kautilya said, see, whether it's maritime or land, the principles of Kautilya really apply in that sense. So it's not that you're using the army and therefore the navy is different. No. Attitude towards ally, attitude towards a friend, an alliance partner, where you make tactical arrangements and your dependable friends against your dangerous friend. That's a lovely word, dangerous friend. You know, I mean, all that would apply whether it's a maritime zone or not maritime zone. I purposely did this because I wanted the answers to be out. I think what I'll do now is, I will, of course, people have said, thank you very much. Vijayalakshmi, do you want to say very quickly something? Very, very quickly, Vijayalakshmi has to say something very quickly. 30 seconds. I respect professors. I
give no, sir. Basically, I wanted to congratulate the speaker. It is not easy. But then, of course, at the same time, I would say that it was a bit simplistic interpretation of Kautilya. Yeah. And therefore, and then also, hum aapko sun kyun rahe hain? हम लोग हिस्ट्री स्टूडेंट नहीं है ना कि हम लोग आपको सुन के रहे हैं बिकॉज हम आपको हम चाहते थे कि आप रेलेवेंस बताइए कौटिल्य का. दैट वाज द मेन थिंग जो आपने बताया नाम दंड योग व्हाटएवर वो सब बेसिकली जानते हैं इनको बेसिक पॉलिटिकल साइंस का नॉलेज है. रेलेवेंस चाहते थे आपसे थोड़ा बहुत. दैट्स ऑल आई वांटेड टू से. अदरवाइज इट वाज अ वेरी गुड अटेम्प्ट.
You know, yeah. Our main audience is actually students. Our main audience
I see. I didn't know that. Then it's fantastic.
I'm very happy to have teachers and like you present here. And yeah, we can have different levels of discussion, which is why I keep 1 hour as a limit. I realize that 1 hour attention span now starts wavering off, you know.
Yeah.
Now, my request to every once again, thank you, everybody who's asked for certificates, many people may not want certificate. Please send us an email. Don't put it in the Zoom chat box, because Zoom chat box will go away as soon as we shut down the Zoom. So don't put it right to us. We are also keeping a record of who's present, who's not present. We hope you enjoy taking part in it. And as I said, we are doing the series. Those who emails are with us, we'll keep you in our mailing box. We'll bother you like hell. I really feel that we want to now get into it. This is the starting only. As we move up the ladder, we'll have different formats of discussions. I mean, the talk that you wanted just now, Vijay Lakshmi, is best done on a panel discussion where each person speaks for 5-7 minutes and they interrogate each other. You know, I completely agree with you. At this stage, in a 30 minute, it has to be simplistic, especially looking at Kautilya, who covers everything, down to having a controller of weights and measures. Why it is Sam, Dan, Bhed, Dand? It's not Dand, Bhed. Dand is always last. First, baatchit kijiye, phir jeetne ki koshish kijiye, phir split kijiye. सब फेल करता है तब डंडा आता है. इट्स वेरी लॉजिकल. इट्स वेरी लॉजिकल.
यस यस यस.
बट टू अंडरस्टैंड दैट इंट्रोडक्शन के लिए आई थिंक दैट वाज द होल आईडिया. या सो यू वेरी मच डॉक्टर मेधा बेस्ट फॉर योर टाइम फॉर कमिंग.
थैंक यू मेधा. थैंक यू वेरी मच.
वी वुड लाइक टू हैव मोर इंटरेक्शन.
थैंक यू वेरी मच सर. थैंक यू.
थैंक यू सो मच. थैंक यू फॉर हैविंग मी. थैंक यू.
बिल्ट अप.
थैंक यू सर. वेरी ग्रेट डिस्कशन.
Thank you, Vedha, and spread the word around. We shall see you next Friday. Time to be notified. The time be adjusted by the speaker or our timing also actually. Sometimes you also
adjust
that. But it has to be every single Friday without fail. Please note it in your diaries. So once again, thank you all very, very much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.